Hi, allow me to introduce Professor Figali. Professor Figali got his PhD in 2007 under the supervision of Professor Luigi Embrizio. He was a faculty at the University of Texas Austin and then moved to the ETH Zurich in 2016 as a chair professor. Professor Figali has won an impressive list of awards, including the Picard-Vilmont Prize in 2011, EMS Prize in 2012, Picard 2012 of the College de France, 2015 edition of the Stampitcher Medal, 2017 edition of the Fecinali Prize for Mathematics, and then finally, in 2018, he won the Fields Medal for his contributions to the theory of optimal transport and its many applications. Without further ado, let's hear from Professor Figali on optimal transport from nature to machine learning.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you very much for the presentation. And I would like to also thank the organizers of this beautiful event. I'm really sorry that this event is taking place online. I think it will be, of course, much better to have an event in presence to meet in person all the participants. Due to the current condition, unfortunately, that's what we have to do. But still, I hope you will all enjoy this event. And about today, I'm gonna give a talk based mostly on some topics that has been very important for me, which is optimal transport. So that has been mentioned in the citation for my Fields Medal. And I would like, let's say today, to give you a sense of what is optimal transport and what are some of its applications. So to do that, I'm gonna share now my slides with you. And okay. And so let me start. The title of today is Optimal Transport from Nature to Machine Learning. So I would like to give you an overview of the theory and to show you why this theory is important and is broad. So let me start from very far away, back in the past. So the origin of optimal transport dates back to Gaspar Monge. So we are at the end of the 18th century, roughly 1789, 1789, French Revolution, and then after that there was Napoleonic era, and Monge worked during this period. And Monge was interested in military application. He wanted to build fortifications so that France could efficiently conquer Europe, and they wanted so to transport material all across Europe to build fortifications. So the question is, if I want to build fortifications and have the material that is extracted from the mines and has to be transported across Europe, what's the most efficient way to do that? So you want to minimize the transportation cost because transporting material is costly. And for Monge, in its view of optimal transport, he considered what's called by now the Monge cost. The cost considered by Monge is the travel distance. So the idea is that if I want to move material for 100 kilometers, I will pay 100. If I want to move a certain amount of material for 1,000 kilometers, I will pay 1,000. So the amount of cost I pay is proportional to the number of kilometers between the two locations. Now, this was the beginning of a story, which went on now for many, many years. And the main contribution after Monge actually came 150 years later. And this is due to Leonid Kantorovich. So we are now in Russia, roughly during the period of World War II. So in the 1940s, Kantorovich saw the Monge problem, but he kind of looked at it from a different viewpoint, more towards, let's say, an economic viewpoint. So he wanted to find a mathematical formulation of optimal transport where it could kind of make it non-deterministic. What do I mean by non-deterministic? The idea is the following. So for Monge, in Monge formulation, in mathematical formulation by Monge, only allowed to move material from one point to another. So if I had some mass at X, this mass had to go to Y. So in some sense, each mass, amount of mass in one location could only go to one single destination. But mathematically, this is not very efficient when you want to model economics problem. Because for instance, if I have bakeries like in this picture, let's say I have this bakery here that produce some bread that has to be distributed to multiple coffee shops, then It's not true that all the bread which is located at this bakery will go to a single coffee shop. I would rather maybe send some amount here, some amount here, and some amount here. And then the amount that has been that arrives to this coffee shop perhaps is not enough. And then this amount needs also to be taken from this bakery as well. So you see, it's a complicated combinatorial problem, and Kantorovich kind of set the basis for the mathematical foundation of these studies. He saw it as a linear programming problem, and then because of, let's say, his contribution, he received actually the Nobel Prize in economics. So we are in 1975. Going on, then, there have been work in the 1980s, mostly by, first by Benier and Rach and Duschendorf, and then by many mathematicians, where they made the problem more abstract. So they said, okay, now I have a transportation cost, which is a function C of xy, which can be many things, can be the distance, can be something else. And I want to minimize the total transportation cost among all possible way of moving the mass, let's say, from this distribution to this distribution, right? So I want to build maybe this castle. This is the material. But now the cost could be something more complicated than just the distance. And then you ask some natural questions. So I'm looking for an optimal transport, but does it exist? So am I talking about the empty set? Nothing. Or I can prove that the optimal transport do exist. Perhaps they are unique. And maybe can we understand how they look like? So these were many questions that mathematicians studied and answered in the last 30 years. And let me mention that the choice of the cost is fundamental for this question. So if you change cost, the problem changes and the solution changes. So for instance, in Monge, the cost was the distance, x minus y, Euclidean distance. Now, if for most of the application actually that are relevant for, that have been relevant to me, the natural cost is not the distance, but rather the distance square. So x minus y square. Okay, I put a constant in front, which is irrelevant, 1/2, more for, let's say, connection with physics. So this looks more like a kinetic distance, a kinetic energy, sorry. And that's a very natural cost. It just comes up naturally. But then also you can be a bit more, you have to be maybe even more, let's say, careful if you really are interested in application to, let's say, economics. What I mean is that if I want to move goods between cities, and I need to take care also of the geography. For instance, if there is a lake or a mountain between two cities, then of course I need my cost has to embed that. So it's not just a matter of kilometers, right? If it's flat between two cities, 100 kilometers can go very fast. But if I have a mountain or a lake in between, then actually it may take much longer. So one needs to take this into account. Mathematicians have done that already. And by now, this is actually very well understood. So let me say that optimal transport by now is a bit everywhere. We have seen a lot of applications. We saw application to urban planning. We have seen application to meteorology, engineering design, statistics, and so on. And today I will try to just mention some brief applications to problems that, have been relevant to me. So as I said, I would like to start from nature. But to start from nature, I will start with a very classical mathematical problem first. And the mathematical problem I'm interested in is the so-called isoperimetric problem. So the isoperimetric problem is just the following. It's a very simple thing to formulate in the plane. So given a curve of a certain length, you want to enclose the maximum amount of area. So the idea is that you consider curves, let's say, of length 1 kilometer, and then you ask yourself, what shape should I give to my curve in order to enclose as much area as possible? Or dually, you can do another thing. You fix the area you want to enclose. Let's say I want to enclose 1 kilometer square of area, and I want to do it with the minimal possible length around it. And the answer to this question, so this is the isoperimetric problem in the plane, and the answer to this question depends where you are. So for instance, if you are in the, let's say, in the interland, so if your, let's say, your domain, your area, your geographic area is inside the in the hinterland, you know, you don't have the sea, then you're going to draw a circle. While if you are on the coast, so if you geographically you live on the coast and you want to build a city with a certain amount of area, you will rather do a semicircle along the coast. So, you know, it's not a coincidence that many cities are actually have this kind of structure. They are round or they are, look like semicircle along the coast. This has been always a question dating back to many, many centuries ago. And the reason is that when you build a city, you of course you want to minimize the length around the city because you want to have so as much space as possible for people to live inside the city, but at the same time you want to minimize the interface, so this boundary, because that's where that's the region from where enemies can attack you. So you want that to be the least possible, because then you need to defend less perimeter, less right, less boundary. So this is why in the hinterland, so if you, let's say you are inside, you do a circle, and let's say on the coast, you can take advantage of the sea and you will draw this semicircle. And this is, let's say, just the big, it's an old story. This dates back now for roughly 3,000 years ago, this question, at least historically in many legends. And these are the fact that this is the mathematical answer, is not just an intuition, has been given many years ago. But here the question is just in the plane, right? So we are in two dimensions and we are trying to solve this question. But I could ask the same question in three dimensions. So in three dimensions, what's the same problem? So here the superimmetric problem is minimize length with fixed area. Okay, so the area is what is enclosed inside, length is the interface. Now if I am in 3D, what I want to do? I want to fix the volume of my object. I have a 3D object. I want to fix the volume and minimize the surface area of my object, okay, the interface around. Now, what's the answer? You can guess the answer in two ways. The first way is like by analogy. The same way here in two dimensions, the answer is, you know, the disk with the boundary given by a circle. If I am in three dimension, I would think that the answer is going to be a three-dimensional ball with the boundary given by a sphere. That's some reasonable intuition. Another way to convince ourselves about the answer could be the following. When as kids, perhaps some of you played with soap bubbles, what they did was the following. So you have this plastic wire to which you attach a film of soap bubbles, and you start to blow air inside this film. And then the film starts to move and wiggle until it detaches from the wire, and then it closes itself up. And now you have this closed object, right? This surface of soap bubbles that inside contains a certain amount of air, the air that you blew inside the bubble, and this air is fixed. So the amount of air inside the bubble is fixed. So that's the volume of your bubble. And suddenly the bubble starts to wiggle, and then after some very few seconds, it becomes round. And the reason why it becomes round, it becomes a sphere, is because, as in many physical problems, the bubble wants to minimize the area of the interface, because the area is like an energy for that system. So the surface area of the bubble is the energy of the system. The bubble wants to minimize the energy, therefore it becomes round. So in three dimensions, soap bubbles tell us the answer to the superimmetric problem. They tell us the answer should be a round sphere. Now, of course, again, this is an intuition, it's not a mathematical proof. You can prove this result mathematically in a rigorous way. This has been done roughly, I would say now, 63 years ago only. So the mathematician could only prove rigorously this theorem in the 1950s. So it's not a trivial result at all. But okay, why am I discussing all this? Where is optimal transport? So here comes another problem. So I told you about soap bubbles. Now, another thing you can consider are actually crystals. So we're used to see crystals in very rigid shapes, right? Some looks like icosahedron, some look like cubes. They have very rigid shape. And the question could be why? So where does this shape comes from? And the point is that crystals have a certain shape, the same way soap bubbles are round. They both are minimizing some energy. So the shape of objects in many physical situations comes from minimization of energies. And it has been in the 1878 first Gibbs, he understood that the droplets, so like soap bubbles or crystals, they arrange themselves because they want to minimize some surface energy. And then in 1901, Wolf found the formula for the surface energy of crystals. So for the soap bubbles, the energy, the surface energy is just the area, the area that we are used to measure. For crystals, you need a more complicated object, but at least a bit on the mathematical side. But in the end, it's just a matter of changing some formulas, but still is a surface energy. And the formulas are actually rather similar to the classical energy of soap bubbles. I mean, you just need a bit of maths. But the principle here is just this. Whether you talk about soap bubbles or you talk about crystals, the shape that you see is because of a minimization principle. These objects minimize surface energy at fixed volume, or let's say they minimize area, perimeter, at fixed volume. Okay, but everything you see, like from spheres to perfect crystals, this comes from a sort of, idealized situation. In nature, we will never see a perfect sphere, we will never see a perfect crystal shape, because there are forces acting on the object. If you have a soap bubble, perhaps there is gravity acting on it, or there is wind that deforms the bubble. If you think about a crystal, perhaps the temperature is such that the crystal tends to be deformed a bit, because the temperature of the room is high enough to make it slightly deformed from its perfect crystalline shape. So the question that you want to ask is, okay, I know what is the ideal shape, a round sphere, a cube, whatever. But what happens if I raise a bit the energy of the system? If I add a bit of energy, will I see the same shape mathematically or not? Let's say the intuition will tell us yes. In nature, when we observe this phenomena, we see this almost the same shape as in the ideal world. So we would expect mathematics to confirm that and tell us, yes, there is a mathematical reason why this happens. And that's what I would be working on. So the idea is that, let's say this pentagon is the idealized crystal at zero energy. So let's say perfect temperature in the system, like zero Kelvin. And then I raise a bit the temperature of the room. And then I start, as it becomes hotter and hotter, the crystal should change a bit its shape. Perhaps not as in my picture. This is a bit of a, extremized picture where I made it all wiggly. But I expect it to change. I don't know how, but I expect it will change a bit. And the question is, in terms of the amount of energy, how much will the shape change? So this is a question that we can try to understand via optimal transport. So we can think of optimal transport as a way to understand how the particles move in the heating process. And then use optimal transport, so this transport phenomena, to understand really the change of shape. So this is actually an idea that mathematically goes back to Knothe, again in the 50s, okay? So I have this transport map that is moving the particles, like the infinitesimal molecules of my crystals, into a wiggly crystal. And we want to understand this phenomenon. We want to understand what happens. We want to understand, again, how the shape changes. And the answer, well, there have been many, many results from the beginning of the last century, so from roughly in the beginning of the 1900s until this century, trying to answer this question. And the final result was given by myself with Maggio Pratelli in 2010, where we proved that the shape of the crystal can change almost by square root of epsilon, where epsilon is the amount of energy. So this is a sharp bound that tells you exactly how much the shape can change. I haven't specified in which sense the shape can change here. I've been a bit vague, but let's say there is a very simple way to define how shape changes. And the importance of this theorem is that this is absolutely sharp. So the square root of epsilon is the best you can hope for. You cannot prove anything better. And also, it's a universal result in the sense that it applies the same time to crystals, but also to soap bubbles, for instance. It's the same. You take a soap bubble, the shape can change at most by square root of epsilon. So it doesn't depend on the object. It's independent of the crystalline structure. It's independent of everything. It's just a universal theorem. But now when you look at this picture and you think about crystals, well, I'm sure none of you has ever seen a crystal of that with that strange wiggly shape. I mean, a crystal maybe gets deformed a bit when you raise the temperature, but if the amount of energy is small, the shape will not change enormously, right? I mean, I don't expect something like that. So I would like to see mathematically, or again, that you know, something better than this should be true in the crystal shape. For soap bubbles, I cannot hope that. But for crystals that are very, very rigid objects, I should hope for that. And that's something I did this year with Yizhang, where we proved that the crystal cannot change its structure. What do I mean by that? We proved the following. So let's say that my crystal was a pentagon, like here, and this is my new crystals after I raised the energy. The only thing that can happen when I raise the energy is the following, that this, let's say, for instance, this side moves, is translated a bit into this side, but you see that the angle of this and this is the same. So the only thing that happened from here to here is that this side moved a bit in this in the direction orthogonal to this hyperplane, but nothing else. So the pentagons remains a pentagon, and all the sides are still parallel to the previous sides that I had. So this is the theorem we could prove. Of course, in the plane, actually, I proved this back in 2011 in two dimensions. So this theorem actually was known for the plane in 2011 already, but this we proved it in every dimension. So for instance, in the physical dimension, three-dimensional object, this is true. So this is the kind of result we could prove. First with optimal transport to get the square root of epsilon with Maggi and Fratelli, and then using other kind of mathematics to reach this rigidity result. So this is one instance of optimal transport. Let me show you another one. There is an equation using metrology, which is called the semi-geostrophic equation, which is just this huge system of PDEs. And I'm not showing you this to you because I expect you to understand this PDE in order to enter into the details of this PDE. I'm just showing this to you because I hope the same way I was when I saw it, you will be a bit scared by it. And the reality is that this is a very challenging equation that is very difficult to solve, even numerically. You cannot just hope to take this, plug in a computer, and let the computer solve it. There are too many variables. It's extremely unstable. So you will build up errors so quickly that it will be very difficult to get a meaningful solution. So you need to understand the principle behind these PDEs. And the principle actually was discovered by a beautiful intuition almost 30 years ago. So let me explain to you in a simplified picture what's going on. Let's say that the PDE I brought you before is using meteorology. Let's say that I'm trying to understand the movement of a cloud. So a cloud is made of many particles. You see the particles on the left. There are all these dots. These are the small infinitesimal molecules that compose the clouds. And then I can take a picture of the cloud at a certain time, and then I take the picture of the cloud, let's say, 1 millisecond later. And this is what I see. And at the microscopic level, I see a lot of dots, which represent the particles, at this time and then at the next time. And the question is the following. If I just look at this picture, can I say who went where? For instance, this particle, where was this particle in this picture? Can I say where it was just by looking at these two pictures? Okay, maybe in this situation, you can still guess it, perhaps. But if the particles become a billion, then it becomes very difficult to guess exactly which particle came where. And Mike Cullen, a meteorologist in Britain, realized that actually particles move in an optimal way, in the sense that what you have to do is to solve an optimal transport problem. You need to understand the coloring from left to right. So you see, I do a coloring to match particles, and you have to do the coloring in such a way that the transportation cost for transporting all the particles from left to right is the least as possible. That's what Mike Cullen guessed in the 90s. He found this intuition, but this was an intuition. He could not make it mathematically rigorous, in fact. The reason was not his fault. The reason is that he was trying to use optimal transport, but the theory of optimal transport was not yet developed enough for making this connection rigorous, and in particular, in order to really use optimal transport here, to then go back and say, okay, now that I know this? Can I solve this equation? Can I find the velocity of the particle? Can I find the pressure? Can I find the buoyancy of the atmosphere? Can I find the semi-geostrophic wind? Can I find all these functions after I solve the optimal transport problem? Because these are really the physical variables that you want. This is a question that fascinated me. I started to work on this problem since 2005. And then finally, I solved it with the Filippis, 2013. In this way, we have been able actually to then prove the existence of solution to the semi-geostrophic systems in two works with Ambrosio, Colombo, and the Filippis. So roughly, so everything has been done between 2012 and 2014. So here, okay, there is a more chronological issue because this paper came out before this one, but this paper has been done before this one. So they are chronologically well done. It's just that, you know, publication time. But what's its relevant here, and why I like this story also, besides the fact that I'm really fond of this problem, is because when you do research, and my example is in mathematics, it's like you want to climb a mountain. You want to get to the tip of the mountain. That's your goal. So you want to prove a theorem. You want to prove something. The problem is that you don't know how to reach the tip. You don't know what is the way. You have perhaps to use some paths that already exist. So it's like using already some mathematics that is known. So you try to climb some paths which are already been climbed by other people. But maybe some moment you get stuck. And then either you find a way to climb forward because maybe you can open new paths and then you keep going up. Or sometimes you get stuck because you were simply on the wrong path. And then if you went and climbed, you arrived almost to the top, but you got stuck. Then you have to be to accept also the frustration of going down, accept that you were on the wrong path, and start again from a different one that maybe eventually will lead you to the top. So for me, this has been roughly a 7 years timescale with this problem. Of course, luckily, not every problem I worked on took me 7 years, otherwise probably would be too depressed. But you know, sometimes you have to face that, and that's life. You know, some problems, then you succeed, and that's the best reward. Many problems, actually, especially when they're challenging, we don't succeed. But that's part of the game. I think it's just important that we all try and put our best in research. So this was a nice story that in this case ended up well. Now I mentioned some machine learning in my title. So perhaps I would like to discuss briefly some other applications. So this was the natural part. This is really where I focus my research. Now in the remaining part of the talk, I would like to mention some other applications, in particular applications that are not necessarily linked to my research, but I hope you will find it interesting. So why optimal transport can be useful in other areas? So optimal transport is an abstract tool now. I used it in these slides to show you that you can transport crystals, okay? It wasn't clear that it was probably the original motivation, I mean, but you transport actually the infinitesimal particles of which the crystal is made of. So that's one. But more, what you can do in general with optimal transport is actually you can use optimal transport to define a distance between distributions. So you just say, okay, the distance between a distribution mu zero and a distribution mu one is the total transportation cost. Of course, this depends on the cost you chose. So for each cost, you have a different distance, where by distance, I just mean a measure of how far two objects are closer or far away. And so optimal transport becomes a way to define many, many distance between different distributions. And also, once you have a transport between two distributions, as I say, you can always transport one to another by solving the optimal transport problem. Why this can be useful, for instance, let me do another abstract example. Let's say I have two images. Images are made of pixels, and each pixel has some color in it. So what I could do when I look at a photograph, I could look at all the pixels it's made of, and I could extract the histogram of all the colors which are inside the picture. So I can check how much yellow is in it, how much blue is in it, how much red is in it, and so on. And I extract this information. So then a photo comes with an histogram of color. Now I could take a different photo and look at its histogram of colors. So now I have two histograms of colors. So these are distributions telling me the intensity of each color. And then I could look at the best way to transport one histogram of color to the other histogram. This will be a way to do color filtering. Like I'm taking the color from one image and match them to the color of a different image, perhaps to do some filtering techniques of the images. We love to apply filters when maybe we take a picture of with our smartphone and then we do funny effects on them very quickly with our smartphone. I mean, behind there is some math behind it always, and you have to choose how to do it. So let me show you how it works. So this is a work by Raban, Delon, and Gousseau, 2010. So let's look at this third line, because I think here you see very sharp with the colors. There is this original picture. Then you take another image. From this image, what you do is that you take out the colors, and then you do an optimal transport from the color, from the histogram of color of this picture to the histogram of colors of this picture, and then you send the colors back to the to the left picture. So you just transport colors with an optimal transport matching technique, and that's what you get. It's nice effect, and then you do a bit of filtering to make it cleaner. Same way here, you had a picture of a Renoir, so not probably very colorful. Then you take an image which is very colorful, like a Gauguin, and you just do color transfer and make a very nice effect, actually. So this is something one can do. Another thing you can do is the following. This is an application which was interesting for me. So random matrices are objects which were introduced in actually nuclear physics in more than 50 years ago to study the nuclei of heavy atoms. But now they actually appear also in neural networks. So neural networks are just this kind of object that are presented in these pictures, where essentially you have neurons, like in our brain, that are connected with a certain intensity to each other. And essentially these neurons are the one that process the information. For instance, they read an image. They process it through many layers. So they send the information from one layer to another of neurons, and then they give you an output. So for instance, you look at an image, your neuron process it, and then you say, oh, this image is a number three. You read numbers, okay? You distinguish this is a number three, this is a number seven. You want the computer to do the same. And sometimes you don't know exactly the weight you need to put between a neuron and another. So you need the way to find the best weights for the connections. And sometimes these become random. They have to be, there is a random effect that helps, so to make them random. And this gives rise to kind of random matrices. So the random matrices are these huge matrices which have all these weights in them. And what we did was again to use optimal transport to study these random matrices, the properties of these random matrices. This is a joint work with Alice Guionet, where in some sense what we did, we have been able to kind of transport some random matrix model to another random matrix model and then extract information out of this transport map. A bit as we did with crystals. We encoded the heating process in the transport map. Here we encoded the randomness in the transport map. And then we had to study the transport problem. So this is one thing, one situation where optimal transport enters. But let me give you very briefly two more. One is in the GANs. So these are very important tools that have been introduced very few, just few years ago, 2014, which work as follows. You have two different, let's say, neural networks, or let's say think of two computers, the generator G and the discriminator D. So these are like two computers that play one against the other. So let's say here I have real images of dogs. And here I have a computer which has been trained to generate fake images of dogs. And then I will start to send images of dogs either from the real sample or from the generator to this other computer, the discriminator, whose role is to say whether the image is a true one or is a fake one. Now, every time the discriminator answers, I will check, is D correct? So if D is correct, it means that the generator has not been very good because it wasn't able to trick the discriminator. And then I will tell the generator, oh, you haven't been very good, you need to improve yourself. Vice versa, if the discriminator is wrong, it means that the discriminator needs to improve himself. And then I will tell him, hey, you have been wrong. Actually, you thought it was a real image, it was a fake. Instead, it was a fake one. And these kind of circles, it makes like an optimization problem where the two computers, the two neural network, G and D, improve together. And in these kind of situations, it's very important to decide how you measure whether an image is a fake one or a real one. In this training process, it's actually very costly numerically. So it's very important to optimize these processes. So there are two things you can do in these situations to optimize your process. The first thing is the following, is what's called the data distribution hypothesis. The idea is the following. So if you're looking at images of dogs, these are very small. So the set of the image of all possible dogs is very small compared to the space of all possible images, because images of dog have some characteristics that other image will not have. So when I look at a dog, I expect to see some ears, the eyes, the nose. So I know already a priori some object that I expect to see in the image. So I can teach to my network to look for them at first. So I can, this lower the complexity of the problem. Then I say it's very important to decide how you distinguish between real images and wrong images. So you have to choose, in this training process, you have to choose how to measure the distance between images. And optimal transport here enters. I told you, optimal transport can be used as a way to measure distances. So this is what are Bassestein GAN. Bassestein is a word for the generic word by now for optimal transport distances. And Bassestein GAN is just GAN using optimal transports. So these have been introduced 3 years ago. And one last point that is important in all this big picture of machine learning is how costly is optimal transport. So you want to solve the optimal transport problem, you want to measure optimal transport distances. How costly is that? This has been always a very challenging problem. And if you look at the very origin of this story, the cost was huge. So if you want to solve optimal transport computationally, standard algorithms, if you have n points, standard algorithms require n cube iteration, which is huge, too much. But very recently, Couture and Perret have been able to introduce a regularization parameter, which is called disentropic normalization, and this allows to approximately solve, so you don't find exactly the optimal transport, but you find a very good approximation of optimal transport, which can be solved in roughly linear time, n to a power slightly larger than one. Here, d is the dimension of the space. So optimal transport not only is a tool now that has shown connection to many things, but now also the fact that it's become computationally easier and easier to solve it, it's opening, I think, a lot of new range of applications that we expect to see in the coming years. So I hope with this presentation, I convince you about that. I would like then to thank you for your attention. And this is a picture of Zurich for those of you who have been to Zurich. So thank you very much.
Hi. Thank you, Professor Figali, for the wonderful talk. We do have a lot of questions on the stage already. Maybe I can start with this one from Xinjiang, who's a student from Tokyo. The question is really asking, there are a lot of mathematical problems. And then the question is whether questions these days are easy to solve by one mathematician or through collaboration between different mathematicians, or a lot of mathematicians. And then, well, in general, the question is collaboration important to solve mathematical problems?
Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank everyone for attending the talk. I'm glad that many people liked it. And so about this question, I think collaboration is fundamental in mathematics. So we should forget this idea that mathematicians can do research just by themselves. Even if there is a theorem or a result of a paper has been proved by just one single mathematician, it always builds up on the work of many others. So it's really by now a collaborative discipline, independent of how many collaborators we have. I think it's nice to have collaborators and to discuss with people, but in any case, even without that, we should not think that people just stay in their corner and now do mathematics just without ignoring completely what happens around them. That's not the case. So yeah, collaboration is fundamental, and cooperation and the fact that so many papers appear, we always rely on the work on others. So that's my view.
I see. Well, thanks for the answer. So there's another great question from the same Xinjiang. He's asking, is it possible to link the optimal transport to other fields in math, such as differential equations or geometry, or to use the field in other fields to solve the problems of optimal transport? Or what ways, more mathematical tools that you use to solve the problems in optimal transport?
Well, I would just say optimal transport is connected to many areas. I just presented a small subset of them. It's connected to probability, it's connected to Euler equations, it's connected to geometry, actually, also differential geometry. People have used it to understand the geometry of manifolds. So there are a lot of things, but these are, they're distinct. So there is the problem of optimal transport by itself that you want to solve. And by now there is a very good understanding of how to solve the optimal transport problem, theoretically. Still the numerical aspect, I say, is very challenging. There have been very important recent results, but it's a very important topic. And then how you take optimal transport and you apply to other areas, that's a completely different problem. And for that, sometimes it works perfectly, sometimes it doesn't work. So also one shouldn't think that optimal transport can solve everything. That will be a false message. Just it has applications. When it works, it can work very, very well. In some cases, just it doesn't work, and that's it. We just need to use other tools. So
I have to say I completely agree. I've seen applications of optimal transport in machine learning a lot. And sometimes I worry whether they are used in the correct way, actually. So, so this is another question from Thomas. The question is, do you think optimal transport theory can be applied to solve problems related to corona pandemic, such as transporting vaccine against corona or transporting medical products?
I think, this relates very well to what I just said. So optimal transport, sometimes it works great, sometimes it doesn't. Here in corona pandemic, I don't see a connection to it. It's an interesting question, but I don't see an obvious way of applying it to corona pandemic. I think there are other models and other tools to understand pandemic transmission and evolution. An area, in medicine, where optimal transport, I think, can be very useful is, in again, related to the fact that optimal transport can be used for image recognition. So, for instance, you can think of optimal transport as a way to study movement of cells in blood, or if you have several images of several MRIs over different amount of times, you can try to use optimal transport to understand the evolution of this. I think there are tools. The optimal transport provides tools which can be applied in many areas and many directions. The particular case of corona, unfortunately, I don't see any. And I think, it's not a problem. When it works, it's great. When it doesn't, it's okay. I mean, likely mathematics is very big and there are many, many tools. So it's not optimal transport will not be the right tool, but that's fine.
I see. Well, we do have quite a number of other questions on the stage, but then I think we are running out of time. Let me just thank Professor Figali again for the wonderful talk. And too bad, due to COVID, we can't have you here in Singapore, and we can't hear the big applause from the audience. But I'm sure everybody enjoyed the talk. Have a good evening, everybody. Yeah.
Thank you so much, and it was a pleasure to at least give a virtual talk. And I'm sorry I couldn't ask virtual questions, but thank you so much for attending the talk. And thanks, Sun Jun, for moderating.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.